So any doubts regarding yesterday? Let's clear that and move ahead. Nothing? Okay.
Calling these Italian millets and American millets and African millets, you know, and we also encourage saying that, you know, we have to consume local food. How this sounds like a contradictory statement. Can we explain that a bit?
Yeah. So they have been given the name because they were very much prevalent in those regions in a large quantity and many people were using it. But fortunately, I think India has been a country from starting from, be it religion, be it the culture, be it the cuisine, we have diversity in everything. Even the soil is different in each region. So we have been lucky enough to have all the types of millets being locally present within our subcontinent itself. So we are very fortunate that even today, when we wished that it has to be, we want to consume it, it has been available for all of us, whether it is the best quality or probably adulterated, but at least we wish for it, it is available for us. So all the five of these millets have been cultivated in India from many years, ages, and we have, it is local as well as universal. So that is the speciality, especially about Indian region. So we have all of them. And let me not say that these are the only five which are present. These are the five which we have gotten our hands on, been able to give to the patients and find results with. There are many more, of course. Anything which has a fiber percentage of more than 8 would qualify as a good grain. And we need, but other than that, other than the fiber content, the extra properties of it are yet to be researched about. So there might be, each region might have another type of grain. So we are yet to dig them out, cultivate them to an extent which they will be available to everyone, give it to the patients and see what healing properties, additional healing properties they will have. So in this journey, we have had one old man bring us another type of grain, which he had a local name for it, which was different from the existing five Siridhanya. But unfortunately, we were not, he gave us just very little. And we were not able to cultivate it to an extent where we could experiment with it. So such grains, there will surely be many more, and we urge others to come forward with it, do their own research or give it to us so that we can also work with it. So please don't be under the impression that these are the only five. The world has lot of diversity and lot of variety, and I'm sure there will be many more which are yet to be worked upon. Okay. So, yeah.
Can you please explain once again about the ligands and the antioxidant? How
does lignans?
Yes, what we explained yesterday.
Yes.
Lignans.
Okay.
Yeah, so I could break it out and explain yesterday.
Okay. So lignans are basically polyphenolic compounds. So what is the speciality of a polyphenolic compound is what is important. So as I said, carbon has the capacity to have 4 bonds around it. It is usually in this tetrad shape. So it can attach to 4 places. So because of this, this is a cyclic structure. If it's all H, then it's a benzene ring. when one OH is present, then it's a phenol, a single unit of a phenol. And there are double bonds present. So now this carbon has 1, 2, 3, 4 attached. This carbon has 1, 2, 3, 4. Each carbon has 4 places where it is attached. So what happens when there is a free electron? This electron forms a double bond here with this carbon. So then this carbon cannot have a double bond here. So this double bond is lost. This gets shifted here. This electron gets shifted here to make it 4 for this carbon. So now it is 1, 2, 3, 4 for this carbon. But then again, this carbon cannot have 5 attached, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So then this electron shifts and comes here. Are everybody following? So the carbon can be attached to 4 places only. So when this free electron comes and makes a double bond with this carbon, the double bond which it had here with this carbon gets shifted to this place. So then the double bond which was here in between these two carbons gets shifted to this place. So now this double bond is an extra one. So this electron which was here, the double bond is between because of the electrons present there. So here this shifts here. So in that way, there is a possibility of an electron continuously getting rotated and absorbed within the cycle, within a cyclic structure of the carbon designed in that way. So because of this special structure being present, so we do not keep showing the double bond shifting constantly. It is usually represented as a circle. The electron keeps revolving, and that's why it is represented as a circle. So the double bonds keep shifting. So this process keeps happening continuously. So because of this structure, it is capable of absorbing free electrons. And this makes it what is going to give you antioxidant property of absorbing the free electrons. And thus it is removing that electron which is capable of producing damage in your body, cell damage, cell death, or the instability leading to the onset of cancer. So that capacity is there because of this structure of a phenol ring. But lignans are polyphenolic compounds. So this kind of units, there are multiple. So they have the capacity of absorbing many free radicals. So that is what makes this structure very important. I hope it is clear now to everyone. And this is present in the outer fiber of millets. So when we consume unpolished millets, just dehusked and not polished millets, we are capable of getting the benefits of these lignans, and that is why they are anti-cancerous in nature. That is why they are going to help our health to a great extent. Is it clear? I hope this repetition has made it more clear.
One more question. You said apart from the outer layer, flax seeds have same properties.
Yes.
Are there any other foods other than flax seeds and unpolished millets which have these capabilities?
In general, they say whole grains. Yes. But more so in millets, the positive millets. There are a few other, the outer layer of probably dicotyledons also might have it to some extent. I'm not very sure about that. But there will be more sources. But what we use in a greater quantity is our staple food. So anything else, the quantity we consume will be less. So if it is present in our main staple food itself, then we are assured of getting it. See, if it is there in something which we use once in a while, flax seeds we don't use on an everyday basis. It is not, we cannot eat only flax seeds. So when it is there in our staple food, we are assured of getting the good amount of it which will be effective in our body. Okay.
Also,
Yes.
What we are using for cooking.
Yes.
But let's say people are throwing that water.
Yes.
Is there a chance that they may lose?
They are going to lose the water-soluble vitamins which are present in the grains. Yes. They should use the same water which it is soaked in should be used for cooking. Either the same, you can cook the rice itself in it, or suppose you are draining the rice, draining the water, use it in rasam or use it in your dal. Somehow the water should be going into
and
the cooking,
you know, there is a washing
also. Yes. One time washing is required, not necessary to, like, example, kodo millet. When you wash, the color of the fiber comes into the water, the red color. So there are people who think that that is dust and keep washing it till they get white plain water. So then you will be losing the good elements as well. So washing once is sufficient. You don't need to squeeze it and clean it enough to get white clear water.
So that's why it's most important that, you know, the grains are also naturally grown.
Yes. 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 As of now, I don't think the farmers are not actually putting any pesticides or anything to it, because in the way they are grown, fertilizers they will not take because they are not dependent on water. As I already explained, rice and wheat take up a lot of fertilizer because they are dependent on water. They are water intensive crops. But these do not take up much water. So even if they put fertilizer, the yield will not vary much. So that is why farmers don't use fertilizers while growing millets. And then they are not going to be attacked by pests as long as they are not dehusked. Only after they are dehusked, they have a risk of getting the pests. So that is why as long as the seeds are stored, it is safe. They are not going to be attacked. So as long as they are protected from mice, that is sufficient. Only after making it into rice, there is a chance of people putting preservatives or chemicals into that to prevent pests. So that we have to be aware of. And as of now, the demand is so high that there is no one who is able to produce a lot of rice and stock it with them and require to put the pesticide into it. It is moving too fast because the demand is more than the supply available. So right now we are not yet worrying about that because of the present situation. The rice, it depends on the environment. If the moisture is more and the heat is more, then the pests tend to attack it quicker. But if it's in a cool environment, it, you can keep it two to three months, they don't get...
Usually the paddy rice would keep it for 6 months also.
Yes, but insects are also wise. They know that millets are good for them, so they tend to attack it faster than paddy rice. Okay, so let's move on.
So you told about the cleansing property of the millets.
Yes.
So is the reference for this from Ayurveda or is it a modern research and how strong the evidence is?
So as an evidence, if you're asking for reference, we cannot give you any textual references. There are some mentions about it, but see, now we are talking about diseases like cancer, diabetes, hypertension, which were not as prevalent during the Ayurvedic texts. When the Ayurvedic texts were written, these diseases were not the main focus of a doctor at that time. So we cannot expect them to have written that for cancer this is good, because cancer was not that rampantly there. It was very, very, very rarely seen disease in the Ayurvedic scriptures. So we cannot say that we have got all this information from the Charaka Samhita as such. There are mentions of it, like I said, little millet being used for injuries has been mentioned. And even in the Charaka Samhita, there are few verses about it. But all of it we have got from there, we cannot say. It has been a process of learning through observation, one thing, in our own clinic. And it is both. So some references, some ideas which we have received, and then we have got the results in the patients and now can tell it confidently that this is for this and this is for this.
This evidence, how strong is it? just like a modern way of researching the
thing? No. No. We are the first ones to be telling about this as a medicinal properties. So we cannot say that we have done scientifically the methodological way. Not yet. People are yet to take that up and do it.
Mostly got by the clinical trials.
Yes. There are references, and based on that, experimented clinically, we can say. So if it was used from before, then we could give you textual evidences, but it was used without having the knowledge that it is good for this, it is good for this. It was just used commonly as a food, not like to cure this, to cure that. So that is why we are not able to give you references in that manner. So we are the ones who are telling that this is the right food and saying why it is the right food and saying for what it is, which disease, which is good. So we cannot, it is yet to be researched in that manner. We are welcome for people to who will be having the resources to do it, and we are open to that in the future.
This question can be answered by connecting the dots also, right? You know, when people were, you know, eating millets, you know, then lifestyle diseases were not there. And there are enough proofs already through China study and nutritional study that happened for 20 years, saying that the modern, you know, eating habits are the cause of cancer and, you know, and heart disease. So going, taking that away and taking a step back, where there is no disease, kind of answers it itself also. You don't have disease to start with. Modern lifestyle kind of caused it. Like, then going back may actually reverse this.
Diet is one of the parts of lifestyle, but you cannot...
Let's move on to the next topic now. We'll talk about water first. So it's not just about millets. That's not the only topic we are discussing here in this whole thing. So the focus has been, yes, on millets, but everything else around us is also equally important. Say the oils are important. The containers in which we eat are important. The way we cook is important. And equally important is another major part. 70 to 75% of our body is water. So the water we drink is also equally important. And being able to drink good water is surely going to give you good health. And when the water is not right, being healthy is difficult. So let's talk a little bit about water. So I think by now most of you already have steel bottles to drink the water. So first thing, how do we cleanse the water which we get in our taps or the system which is being through which we are provided with water. So the first thing which we need to do is allow the water to stand. Such a simple step, but we usually forget it, that allow sedimentation to occur. The gravitational force is going to let the bigger particles settle down and do the first step of purification of water. So this is one simple step which most of us are forgetting to do. There are surely going to be some amount of impurities which are coming with the water. So just allow the water to stand so that the heavy particles with the help of gravity settle down. And when you have done this, it becomes evident that next thing, the tap which we use in the water containers should not be in the bottom level. You must have been seeing, we are using a cup with a long stick to take the water out. So once sedimentation has occurred, do not use the water which is at the bottom. The sediments are at the bottom. So we have to use the water which is at the top part and leave the water which is at the bottom with the sedimented particles. The next step is treating it with copper. it has been an age-old practice in our Indian tradition to use water which has there in copper. So why is copper important? So there are, again we come back to the electrons. Electrons seem to be coming into focus quite often. So there are 29 electrons in the structure of copper. And the arrangement goes as, these are the orbitals, different levels of energy in which the electrons are distributed. So in the S orbital is oval in shape, round in shape. So in the center is the nucleus and the electrons are running around the nucleus. So S orbital, the maximum number of electrons which can be present is 2. So at the first energy level there are only one s orbital, and in that there are 2 electrons. Then the second level, energy level, there are 2 s electrons, and p orbitals are usually represented in this shape, and they are present in 3 dimensions. So x axis, y axis and z axis. So it is possible to have 6 electrons in the p orbitals. So 2 plus 2, 4, 4 plus 6, 10. Again, 10 plus 2, 12, 18. So the filling happens in this way. Okay. So the last orbital, the d orbital, is having 9 electrons in it. Complete d orbital should have 10 electrons. If it has 10 electrons, then it is stable. S orbital can maximum have 2 electrons, and if it has 2 electrons, it will be stable. So this d orbital wants to become stable and pulls away 1 electron from the next energy level, that is the 4s electron, and it becomes 3d10. Then this becomes 4s1. Again, 4s orbital feels unstable and it tries to pull away this electron and becomes 4s2, and this becomes 3d9, and again that electron is constantly moving between the 3d9, 3d10 and 4s1, 4s2. So the electron keeps shifting. And because of this property of copper, the moving electron, as I said, this electron which moves has the capacity to damage cells. So what does it do? It is going to damage the cell wall of the bacteria or the virus, and it eliminates the bacteria and viruses which are present in the water. So this is how copper is going to help you to cleanse your water. And then what do we do with this killed bacteria and viruses? So what is the solution to remove them is using of drumstick seeds. If you go back to the villages, you will observe that if there is a well, usually there are drumstick plants around the well. Or if there is a pond from where the villagers collect water, drumstick plants are usually, trees are present all around the periphery of that. So the reason is the drumstick, when it becomes big, then dries, then the seeds fall into the water. It has the capacity to absorb all the suspended particles. The heavy particles would have settled down because of sedimentation. The remaining substances which were suspended in the water, it absorbs all of them. So a simple way to purify your water would be to use a copper strip, or you can use a copper vessel as well, but cleaning the copper vessel each time becomes a tedious process at home. So we usually suggest just use a copper strip. So for a 20 liter vessel, you can use your forearm length of copper strip this wide. It will be sufficient to remove all the bacteria and viruses present in the water. And then 2 drumstick seeds, dried drumstick seeds, remove them and throw them away, since they would have absorbed all the suspended particles and the dead bacteria. And once in 2 days, if you are going to clean the copper, you will have pure water ready at a, it is affordable for everyone. So you just have to make sure that the vessel you are putting it in is again not plastic, and you can either use a mud pot or a steel vessel. So this is a simple way in which you can purify your water for your consumption. Yeah, so at least 6 to 8 hours when you allow the water to be standing and in contact with copper, this process is going to happen. So don't heat the water in copper vessels. That is not good. Using copper for cooking is not good. It's only for storage which copper is good to be used. And how do we clean the copper? So everyone knows that copper is cleaned when you use a sour substance. So it can either be tamarind soaked in water used to rub the copper, or you can use nimbu peels, the lemon peel, which after squeezing it will still have some amount of juice left in it. That can be used to clean the copper. At least once in 2 to 3 days, clean the copper, then you will be able to get good water for drinking. Filter, if you want to use the filter, after filtration, make sure that it is going through this process. It is, yeah. It again comes back to the electrons and the way in which the hydrogen and the OH, so water is H2O, H plus and OH minus. The way it becomes arranged when it goes through this process, the alignment, it is, that is why it is called structured water. And inside our body, it doesn't cause an imbalance when it is in a structured way. Usually flowing water is structured water, but we cannot directly go and get flowing water for our consumption. So this process brings it close to that kind of structure where the H plus and the OH minus get aligned in a way so that they don't cause imbalance in our body. I think probably I can.
How many days we have to clean the vessel?
2 to 3 days.
But suppose the big pot.
Yes. Yes, that is why it is difficult. We suggest use a steel vessel with a copper plate.
But is it available in the market?
Yes.
Copper plate called?
Yes, sheets are available. You can get it cut into appropriate sized.
Yes.
We have even for the water bottle, steel water bottle, we have a strip which can be put inside.
Okay. All the while?
Yeah, you can remove it, clean it, put it back. When you are traveling, you can use that. Okay, so we have.
In Ayurveda, they say copper is hotter. Like, no, it's heating. It heats up the body. So, better not to use it in summer. And they say if you're using copper all the time, like in the morning, it's okay. But if you're using it all the time, better to not use it for 1 month and then use it for 3 months like that.
I personally am not aware about this. But as far as I can see, there is not going to be any problem caused by using this. But I have seen people who have more heat in their body wear rings made of copper to cool their body. This is also a practice which I have come across. Just a copper ring on their finger, or they wear it around their neck. People who have more issues of heat in their body, to cool down the body, they use copper ring. This is what I have seen. I'm not aware about what you are saying. Yes, yes. As long as you are not heating it, cooking in the copper vessel, it is good. So the problem when you heat it in that, there is substance entering your body. And that is slightly toxic to the liver. So many people, when we tell them to do this, they say copper is toxic to the liver. Copper, when you are just making it in contact with the water, you are not going to be consuming. Only when you heat it in that, there is chances of that happening. So don't use copper vessels for cooking. Okay? So first I said
alkaline water is
So we are talking about water which is potable, how to purify it for your use. There is of course now the problem of very acidic water being collected when you are doing rainwater harvesting. There is the question of lot of chemicals being present because of the pollution through industries, which is not really potable at all. So to make that kind of water potable, there are different processes. Like I think you are referring to the tanks which are being, yes. So that is when you are using water which is acidic in nature to make it potable. We are talking about potable water, how to purify it for consumption and ensure that it's not going to be harmful to you. Okay, so instead of using the water purifiers, this is a much more economic and much more healthy way to use the water. So we spoke about plastic being to be avoided, but then let us see why plastic is now such a dangerous substance for us and how it has come into our lives to an extent that we have water bottles. Yes.
She was telling me
heat.
So what Ayurveda tells is there are only two things in life, mainly about heat and cold, sun and moon. So sun represents all heat in the prithvi, and chandra represents the coolness in the
silver is very similar to copper in its electronic structure. It is going to have the same thing happening at the next level between 4D9 and 5S. The electronic structure of silver is very much similar to copper. It's just this process happening between 4S and 3D will be happening there between 4D and 5S. So silver is also very similar to copper. The only difference is because of its larger size and the different energy level, it will not be equivalent to copper because the microbes which we are talking about are very, very minute. It is also effective, but copper would be one step better than silver if you are talking about because of the energy level and the size of the particle. So silver atom is a little huger, but it will still also have a similar effect. So probably that would be a good thing. What he is saying is in the summer, those who have lot of heat could probably replace it with silver. But ideally, copper will have the best effect. Okay? If you have to worry about the heat and cold, if your body is so reactive towards it, usually there are other ways in which you can balance it, I guess.
Long back, bro, my grandmother, she used to keep one vessel under the moonlight with water. And the boys, you know, from whose nestle the blood comes out,
yes,
she used to give them.
Yes.
So it was very curable.
Yes. In homeopathy also, we have medicine made from lunar energy as well. Yes. Cooling effect will be got to the body. Yeah. Yes. Okay. So we were talking about plastic. Plastic being present in everything which we eat. Of late, lunch boxes are also plastic. We have hot food which we order online, we get it to our house, being sent in plastic containers. The food is almost boiling hot, it is being put into plastic containers. Milk comes in plastic packets. Oils come in plastic packets. Water bottles are all plastic. So everyone knows that plastic is a non-biodegradable substance. So when our body, when we die, we put it into the earth, microbial action will dissolve it and the nutrients are returned back to the environment. But plastic is one substance which even microbes are unable to act upon. Microbes can devour anything almost, but plastic is something which they are unable to act upon. So when even that is not happening in the earth, imagine to what all the plastic must be causing inside our body. So it's when we are consuming substances which are constantly in contact with plastic, especially liquids, and more so that which is hot, when we consume it, it is going to carry the nanoparticles of plastic within it, and we are consuming it. One day it will not cause any problem. 2 days it will not cause any problem, because it is too small amount to cause problem. But then, because of this, we are not becoming aware of what it is, what is happening inside. See, we have some poisonous substance, if we take a little bit and immediately our body reacts, we know that this is not good for us. But the substances which we are consuming now are slow poisons. We do not find the effect happening in us immediately, so that we start avoiding them soon. They are accumulative poisons. They accumulate inside our body, and when they reach a threshold, they start showing their effects. So the plastic which we are consuming is going to be form a layer in the intestine. It slowly starts depositing inside our intestine. So when these nanoparticles are going to be lining the intestine, the main function in the intestine was absorption. So absorption of all the nutrients which we require from the food which we eat. After digestion, the nutrients are present. We are supposed to absorb them in the intestine. But now this plastic is lining the intestine layer, and it is now reducing the absorptive capacity. So many people were saying, we are taking lot of vitamin tablet, but still no effect. Still there is deficiency. We are taking calcium tablet, still there is no effect. I am having calcium deficiency. We are eating good amount of greens, yet we are having iron deficiency. So we are taking iron tablets directly, but still iron deficiency is widely prevalent. So why is this happening? Because we are losing the capacity to absorb the nutrients from the small intestine, and one of the main reasons for that is the plastic which we are using in our food. Without a second thought, I think everything in our kitchens have suddenly changed into plastic. Even heating, cooking, we are doing microwave cooking, putting everything in a plastic vessel and cooking in that. So it is obvious that we are going to be consuming a little about amount of plastic. So what happens as a result of this deficiency of absorbing nutrients? Evident is all the vitamins, but then there are many micronutrients which we do not measure on a daily basis. When we go to the lab, we do not do tests for many micronutrients. The major ones, few are measured. But there are so many more which we don't do lab tests on, but which have a very important role in our body. They're required in such small quantities. We do not test for those substances, and yet they have such an important role in the body. For example, our hair quality. So hair is dependent on micronutrient balance, and things like selenium, zinc and all, which are required in such small quantities, are becoming, we are getting deficiency of that, because we are not able to absorb it, and the result is hair fall. We are seeing baldness in men, which used to come at 60, 70, now at 25, 30. Women were earlier blessed with good hair by their nature. Now women are having problem of hair fall and baldness. Baldness was never seen in ladies, only in men it was seen. But now women are also having complaints of baldness. That is just one example. Other thing is hormone imbalances. So hormone secretions are all have to be in a correct balance for the body to function. Hormones are like the supervisors in our body. So if the supervisor is not working properly, the whole thing under that is not going to be proper. For the hormone balance to be there, you need a micronutrient balance. And that itself is becoming deficient because of the plastic in our food. My mic. And it is also known that plastic is one of the causes for cancer. Plastic has become one of the causes for the number of cancer patients increasing day by day. One of the main reasons is also cancer. There are lot of chemicals which are carcinogenic, and one of them is the plastic. So plastic is a long, very big, huge molecule, and it tends to interfere with the metabolism in our body and can lead to cancer. So that is why it is best to avoid all types of plastic. There is safe food grade, that is all standards, but why take the risk? It is best to avoid all types of plastic when it comes to our food, at least. And we also know plastic is water repelling. So inside the gut, the water absorption in the body also reduces. The symptoms of heat, many people getting heat, is also because of plastic being used in our food. So once we speak about plastic, the topic of oils came up. Plastic containers, plastic cans, plastic packets being used for the selling of our oils. Oils have a tendency to take in more plastic as a liquid. The amount of plastic which you will get into your body is more when you have oils in contact with the plastic. So be careful not to use the oils which have been packed in plastic containers. So next we'll move on to the topic of oils. Yes, of course. Nonstick is also a form of a polymer, which is a plastic kind of substance. Teflon. So the oils which we buy in the market, what do they actually contain is the question which we have to ask ourselves. So when we look into the process of oil extraction, it is very evident that the amount of oil which you can extract from, say, groundnut or say sunflower seeds or be it till, all of these give you a very less percentage of oil. So anyone can tell me the rate at which groundnut is available in the market? 80 rupees per kg. Okay, 80 to 90 rupees per kg. How much oil do you have an idea can be extracted from 1 kg? 1 kg. Huh?
Or 3 kg something,
3.2 or something. Okay. The best processes of extraction can get up to 40%, 30 to 40% of oil can be extracted. So to get 1 liter of groundnut oil, if you require 2.5 to 3 kgs of groundnut, what should be the cost of 1 liter of groundnut oil? If 1 kg costs 90 rupees, 80 rupees, so 80 into 3, 240 rupees just for the groundnut required. And then of course the processing, then you have to add to that the transportation cost, you have to add the profit which the oil extraction person will be making, the profit which the retailer is making, all that. So 1 liter of groundnut oil should cost you at least 300 rupees minimum, keeping the lowest margins. But in the market, can anyone say how much it is available for? 110 to 150 rupees. So how is this possible? This is, groundnut was just one example. Sunflower gives less yield compared to groundnut, the oil extraction process. Till oil is even more less, till you get hardly 25 to 30% of oil. This is the same with all. Rice bran is even more less. Yet, we are getting oils in the market at a very less price compared to the actual substance from which it is extracted. This is possible only because of one thing: they are using very harsh methods for extracting the substances. So to extract the oil, to get the maximum amount of oil, they are putting it through a high pressure and high temperature to extract the oils. A lot of pressure and heat is used to extract the oils, and during this process of high pressure and high temperature, the good substances which are present in the oil, the antioxidants which are present naturally in the oils, all get destroyed. So we are losing the good substance present in it because of the extraction method. Also, chemical substances are used to extract oils, and the residues of these chemicals is going to be present in the refined oils. To make it clear and refined, the process of refining, they use chemicals, and those residues are going to be harmful to us. The next point is that in order to get these oils at such a low price, there is adulteration which is happening. The same way which we spoke about the bomb waste material being the raw material for producing fertilizers, there are two other major industries which produce a lot of waste and they do not know what to do with it. And that is finding its way into our packeted oils. What are these two industries?
Petroleum.
One is the petroleum industry, two is the meat industry. So there is such a large consumption of meat, and all the parts of the animal whichever is being used cannot be consumed. There is a lot of wastage which is produced. So in large containers, the waste meat is boiled and the fat separates. And the separated fat is then poured out, made into large balls of lard, and it is exported to various countries where from wherever the demand is. And India is one of the, I said, the best market for any company can be India, because we have such a large population where they can sell their products. So lard is imported into India from all the countries, and here what do we do with it? It is distributed into all our cooking oils. Though there is a green dot on the packet, they have mixed this lard. It is nothing but dalda. Earlier, dalda would mean vanaspati, which was oils extracted from various herbs in the forest. But now there is no forest for us to go and extract good substances from there. So what is the dalda which is available now? It is nothing but animal fat, which leftover animal fat, which is coming as an adulterant in our oils. The next adulterant, as sir said, is the petroleum industry. Surya is causing the disturbance.
Petroleum LLP mostly adultering in coconut oil.
Yes.
Liquid paraffin. Likely.
In this vanaspati, they label it as veg, right? Give green dal.
Diesel industry or the petroleum industry is another major industry which produces a large amount of waste material. The higher octanes are used as fuel, diesel, petrol. But then there is a lot of, after extraction, there is a lot of substance remaining which is not fit to be used as fuel, which is our mineral oil. So this is being used as an adulterant. And now the chemistry has developed to such an extent, you want any flavor, any odor, there is a small chemical, one drop is sufficient to give you that flavor or that smell. There are chemicals available to adjust the viscosity of the oil, to make the oil thicker or thinner. So everything is readily available. We all know there is no strawberry in strawberry ice cream. It's the same way that if you want coconut oil, there is a chemical ready to be mixed into mineral oil, which will make it smell like coconut oil, taste like coconut oil, and give the thickness of coconut oil. So all these chemicals are readily available in today's world, and this is what is being done for the oil in the oil industry. So it's not one or two or three reasons, multiple reasons why we need to stop using the refined oils. One is the chemicals present, two is the pressure and the heat which are reducing, the removing totally the good substance present in the oil. Three is the adulteration by animal fat, and four is the petroleum industry, and of course the plastic which we are consuming through the oils. So what is an alternative? We are telling you the problem, but then many people say you have to give us an alternative as well. It is impossible to cook without oils. So what is the best alternative is the old methods of extraction of oils. So for that we will be playing a small video through which you can see how it is done.
Store it in a big steel vessel. Forefathers in the olden days. This is the final round of the bullet. After this, they'll be extracting the oil. We can see the process. You see here, it's extracting oil that has been collected in this receptacle. You see, a solid cake has formed in the borders. This they will remove it, they will dry it in the sun, and they will use as a powder. Yes, the bullock is moving around, this lady is extracting the oil. Now we are witnessing the extraction of the oil. Mr. Naveen will explain the process.
ಸ್ನೇಹಿತರೆ ನೋಡಿ ಈಗ ಎಣ್ಣೆಯನ್ನು ಯಾವ ತರ ನಾವು ಹೊರಳಿನಿಂದ ತೆಗಿತಾ ಇದೀವಿ. ಇದು ಕಡಲೆಕಾಯಿ ಎಣ್ಣೆ. ಗಾಣದಿಂದ ಯಾವ ತರ ಎಣ್ಣೆಯನ್ನು ಆಚೆಗೆ ತೆಗಿತಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ ನೋಡಿ. ಇದು ಯಾವ ತರ ಎಷ್ಟು ಪ್ಯೂರ್ ಆಗಿದೆ ನಿಮ್ಗೆ ಗೊತ್ತಾಗುತ್ತೆ ನೋಡಿ. ಈ ಕಡೆ ತೋರಿಸಿ ಅಮ್ಮ, ಈ ಕಡೆ ತೋರಿಸಿ. ಹ್ಮ್, ಹಂಗಿಂದ ಹಾಕಿ, ಇಲ್ಲಿಂದ ಹಾಕಿ, ಕಾಣುತ್ತೆ ಎಣ್ಣೆ. ಇದೇ ಎಣ್ಣೆ ನಮ್ಮ ಪೂರ್ವಜರು ಬಳಸಿ ಸುಮಾರು 80-100 ವರ್ಷ ಗಟ್ಟಿಯಾಗಿ ಇರ್ತಾ ಇದ್ರು.
ಈಗ ಈ ಎಣ್ಣೆ ಸಿಕ್ಕಿದಲ್ಲ, ಇದು ಒಂದೊಂದೊಂದು ಸಾರಿ ಪ್ರಾಸೆಸ್ ಪ್ಯೂರಿಫಿಕೇಶನ್ ಪ್ರಾಸೆಸ್ ನಡೀತಾ ಇಲ್ಲ ಅಷ್ಟೇ ಡೈರೆಕ್ಟ್ ಪ್ಯಾಕೇಜಿಂಗ್ ಹೋಗ್ತಾ
ಇಲ್ಲ. ಈ ಎಣ್ಣೆನ ನಾವು ತಗೊಂಡೋಗಿ ಡ್ರಮ್ಗಳಿಗೆ ಹಾಕ್ತೀವಿ, ದೊಡ್ಡ ದೊಡ್ಡ ಸ್ಟೀಲ್ ಡ್ರಮ್ಗಳಿಗೆ. ಅದನ್ನ ಅದರಲ್ಲಿ ಇಟ್ಟು 3 ದಿನ ಸನ್ಲೈಟ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಇರ್ತೀವಿ. 3 ದಿನ ಸನ್ಲೈಟ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಇಟ್ಟಾಗ ಎಣ್ಣೆ ತೆಗಿಬೇಕಾದ್ರೆ ಉಪಯೋಗಿಸಿರ್ತಕ್ಕಂತ ನೀರೆಲ್ಲ ಅದು ಆವಿಯಾಗಿ ಹೋಗುತ್ತೆ. ಆ ಎಣ್ಣೆನ ನಾವು ಬಾಟ್ಲಿಂಗ್ ಮಾಡಿ ಕಸ್ಟಮರ್ಗಳಿಗೆ ತಲುಪಿಸ್ತೇವೆ.
ಅವರು ಯೋಗೇಶ್ ಬಂದು ಈ ಯೂನಿಟ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಡಿಫ್ರೆಂಟ್ ಪಾರ್ಟ್ಸ್ ಏನೆಲ್ಲ ಇದೆ ಅಂತ ನಮ್ಗೆ ಹೇಳ್ತಾರೆ. ಸರ್ ಹೇಳಿ
ಸರ್. ಗಾಣದಲ್ಲಿ ಮುಖ್ಯವಾಗಿ ಒಂದು 4-5 ತುಂಬಾ ಇಂಪಾರ್ಟೆಂಟ್ ಪಾರ್ಟ್ಸ್ ಇದೆ. ಸೊ ಆಯಿಲ್ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ರಾಕ್ಷನ್ ಪ್ರೊಸೆಸ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಇದು ತುಂಬಾ ಇಂಪಾರ್ಟೆಂಟ್. ಸೊ ಇದು ಮೊದಲನೇದಾಗಿ ಇದು ಹೊರಳು. ಸೊ ಈ ಹೊರಳಲ್ಲಿ ಮುಂಚೆ ಹಳೆ ಕಾಲದಲ್ಲಿ ಖಾರ ಎಲ್ಲ ರುಬ್ತೀವಿ. ಸೊ ಅದೇ ಸೇಮ್ ಮೆಕಾನಿಸಮ್ ಅಲ್ಲೇ ತಯಾರಾಗಿರುವಂತದ್ದು. ಹೊರಳಲ್ಲಿ ಇದು ಇಷ್ಟು ದೊಡ್ಡದು ಇದಿರುತ್ತೆ, ಮುಂದೆ ಒಳಗಡೆ ಆಟೋದಕ್ಕೆಲ್ಲ ಕಾಳ ಹಾಕೋದಕ್ಕೆಲ್ಲ ಜಾಗ ಇರುತ್ತೆ. ಸೊ ಇದೊಂದು ಒನಕೆ ಇದ್ವಿ. ಸೊ ಒನಕೆ ಒಳಗಡೆ ನಿಲ್ಲಿಸಿದಾಗ ಎತ್ತು ತಿರುಗಿದಾಗ ಇದು ಕ್ರಶ್ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ, ಸೀಟ್ಸ್ ಎಲ್ಲ ಕ್ರಶ್ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ. ಸೊ ಸೊ ಇದು ಬಲಮಾನ್ ಅಂತೀವಿ, ತುಂಬಾ ದೊಡ್ಡದ ತುಂಬಾ ಭಾರವಾದ ವಸ್ತು, ಭಾರವಾದ ಮರ ಈ ಗಾಣದಲ್ಲಿ. ಸೊ ಇದನ್ನ ಈ ಬಲಮಾನ ಎಂಡನ್ನ ಈ ಚೈನ್ ಸಹಾಯದಿಂದ ನೊಗಕ್ಕೆ ಕಟ್ಟಲಾಗಿರುತ್ತೆ. ಸೊ ಆ ನೊಗಕ್ಕೆ ಎತ್ತುಗಳನ್ನ ಕಟ್ಟಲಾಗುತ್ತೆ. ಸೊ ಎತ್ತು ಮುಂದೆ ಹೋದಾಗ ಎತ್ತು ಸುತ್ತಕೊಂಡು ಹೋದಾಗ ನೊಗ ಇಟ್ಕೊಂಡು ಅದು ಐದು ಕೃಷಿ ಸೀಟ್ಸ್ ಕೃಷಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ಕೆಲಸ ಮಾಡುತ್ತೆ.
ಈಗ ಯೋಗೇಶ್ ಅವ್ರು ನಮಗೆ ಹೇಳ್ತಾರೆ ಎಷ್ಟು ಸೀಡ್ಸ್ ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಹಾಕ್ಬೋದು, ಎಷ್ಟು ಆಯಿಲ್ ಸಿಗ್ಬೋದು ಅಂತ ಡೈಟೇಲ್ಸ್ ಎಲ್ಲ ಹೇಳ್ತಾರೆ.
ನಾವಿದಕ್ಕೆ ಮೊದಲು ಇದಾಗಿ 12.5 kg ಅಷ್ಟು ಕಡಲೆ ಬೀಜವನ್ನು ಇದಕ್ಕೆ ಹಾಕ್ತೇವೆ. ಸೊ ಡಿಪೆಂಡಿಂಗ್ ಅಪಾನ್ ದಿ ಕ್ವಾಲಿಟಿ ಆಫ್ ದಿ ಸೀಡ್ಸ್. ಸೊ ನಾವು 12.5 kg ಹಾಕಿದ್ರೆ 4-5 liters ಬರುತ್ತೆ, ಅಂದ್ರೆ 30-35% 40% ಎಣ್ಣೆ ಬರುತ್ತೆ. ಸೀಡ್ಸ್ ಗುಣಮಟ್ಟ ಜಾಸ್ತಿ ಇದ್ರೆ, ಸೀಡ್ಸ್ ಕ್ವಾಲಿಟಿ ಚೆನ್ನಾಗಿದ್ರೆ ಸುಮಾರು 5.5 liters ವರ್ಗೂ ನಮ್ಗೆ ಎಣ್ಣೆ ಸಿಗುತ್ತೆ.
Now friends, as we saw the oil extracted in our unit, that we are going to store it in a big steel vessels and we are going to keep it under sunlight for 3 days. So what happens in 3 days, the oil is kept under sunlight, whatever the water we have used to extract the oil, that's going to be evaporated. So after this, and the meantime, the small small particles, sediments are going to settle in the bottom. Oil which is there on the top, we are going to fill it to the bottles and we are going to put the label and send it to the customers.
What you will do with the sediments collected at the bottom, are they of any use or waste?
Yeah, that one is a very very useful portion in the oil extraction, that we can use it for the sabjis and other things where we are making some curry.
We have seen the extraction of oil. Later it has undergone a purification process under the sunlight for 4 days. Now the packaging of the oil is taking place here. The same stainless steel vessel is here. ಈ ಆಯಿಲ್ 4 ದಿನ ಬಿಸಿಲು ಇಟ್ಟಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಈಗ ಬಿಸಿಲು ಇಟ್ಟದ ಆಯಿಲ್ ಪ್ಯೂರಿಫಿಕೇಶನ್ ಆಗಿದ ಮೇಲೆ ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಇದೆ. ಹೇಗೆ ಪ್ಯಾಕೇಜ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಾರೆ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳ್ತಾರೆ. ಮತ್ತೆ ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಆ ಸ್ಟೇನ್ಲೆಸ್ ಸ್ಟೀಲ್ ಒಂದು ಲೇಬಲ್ ಹಾಕಿದ್ದಾರೆ, ಇದು ಏನಂತ ಅವ್ರು ಹೇಳ್ತಾರೆ.
ಇದು ಏನಂತಂದ್ರೆ ಈ ಸ್ಟೈನ್ಲೆಸ್ ಸ್ಟೀಲ್ ವೆಸಲ್ ಮೇಲೆ ಇಟ್ಟಿರೋದು ಒಂದು ಲೇಬಲ್ ಹಾಕಿದೀವಿ. ಇದೇನಪ್ಪ ಅಂತಂದ್ರೆ, ಒಂದು ಯಾರೇ ನೋಡಿದ್ರು, ನಾನು ಈಗ ಫಾರ್ ಎಕ್ಸಾಂಪಲ್ ನಮ್ಮ ಪ್ಲಾಂಟ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಇಲ್ಲ ಅಂತಂದ್ರು, ಇದು 3 ದಿನ ಎಣ್ಣೆ ಸೂರ್ಯನ ಬೆಳಕಿನಲ್ಲಿ ಒಣಗ್ಬೇಕು ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದೀವಿ. ಸೊ ಇಲ್ಲಿಂದ 0, 1, 2, 3 ಅಂತ ಏನ್ ನೋಡ್ತಾ ಇದೀವಿ. ಮೊದಲನೇ ದಿನ ಒಣಗಾದ್ಮೇಲೆ, ಒಂದ್ ದಿನ ಒಣಗಾದ್ಮೇಲೆ 1 ಟಿಕ್ ಮಾಡ್ತೀವಿ, 2 ದಿನ ಒಣಗಾದ್ಮೇಲೆ 2, 3 ದಿನ ಆದ್ಮೇಲೆ 3 ಟಿಕ್ ಮಾಡ್ತೀವಿ. ಸೊ ಈ ಆಯಿಲ್ ನಾವು ನೋಡ್ದಂಗೆ 3 ದಿನ ಒಣಗಿದೆ. ಸೊ ಇದು ಪ್ಯಾಕಿಂಗ್ ರೆಡಿ ಇದೆ ಅಂತ. ಸೊ ಈ ತರ ನಾವು ಒಂದು ನಮ್ಮ ಒಂದು ವಿಜುವಲ್ ಕಂಟ್ರೋಲ್ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳ್ತೀವಿ, ಆ ತರ ನಾವು ಕಂಟ್ರೋಲ್ ಮಾಡಿ ಇಟ್ಟಿದೀವಿ. ಸ್ನೇಹಿತರೆ, ನೀವು ಈ ಬಾಟ್ಲ್ ಅನ್ನು ನೋಡ್ತಾ ಇರ್ಬೋದು, ಇದೇನಪ್ಪ ಇದು ಔಷಧಿ ಬಾಟ್ಲ್ ತರ ಇದೆ ಅಂತ. ಆಕ್ಚುಲಿ ನಾವು ಸುಮಾರು ಒಂದು 15-20 years ಮುಂಚೆ ನೋಡಿದ್ರೆ ಎಲ್ಲಾ ನಮ್ಮ ಟಾನಿಕ್ ಗಳು ಇದೇ ಕಲರ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಇರ್ತಾ ಇತ್ತು. ಇದನ್ನ ಆಂಬರ್ ಕಲರ್ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳ್ತೀವಿ. ಏನಪ್ಪಾ ಅಂತಂದ್ರೆ, ಒಂದು ಎಣ್ಣೆಗಳನ್ನ ಪ್ಲಾಸ್ಟಿಕ್ ಪೌಚ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಬಳಸಬಾರ್ದು. ಎಣ್ಣೆ ಅಥವಾ ನೀರು ಯಾವ್ದೇ ಪದಾರ್ಥ ಲಿಕ್ವಿಡ್ ಫಾರ್ಮ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಇರೋದನ್ನ ಪ್ಲಾಸ್ಟಿಕ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಇರಬಾರ್ದು. ಏನಂದ್ರೆ ಅದರಲ್ಲಿ ಕಾರ್ಸಿನೋಜೆನಿಕ್ ಐಟಮ್ ಇರುತ್ತೆ, ಅದು ಕ್ಯಾನ್ಸರ್ ಕಾರಕ ಅಂತ ನಮ್ಗೆಲ್ಲರಿಗೂ ತಿಳಿದಿರೋ ವಿಚಾರನೆ. ಆದ್ರೂ ತುಂಬಾ ಕಂಪ್ನಿಗಳು ಎಲ್ಲಾರು ಪ್ಲಾಸ್ಟಿಕ್ ಅಲ್ಲೇ ಪ್ಯಾಕ್ ಮಾಡಿ ಆಯಿಲ್ ಅನ್ನ ಮಾರ್ಕೆಟ್ ಗೆ ಕೊಡ್ತಾ ಇದಾರೆ, ಅದನ್ನ ನಾವು ಬಳಸ್ತಾ ಇದೀವಿ. ನಾವು ಗಾಜಿನ ಬಾಟ್ಲಲ್ಲೇ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇದೀವಿ, ಅದ್ರಲ್ಲೂ ಆಂಬರ್ ಕಲರ್ ಅಲ್ಲೇನೆ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇದೀವಿ. ಯಾಕೆ ಅಂತಂದ್ರೆ, ಇದ್ರ ಮೂಲಕ ಸೂರ್ಯನ ಕಿರಣಗಳು ಪಾಸ್ ಆಗೋದಿಲ್ಲ, ಫೋಟೋ ಕೆಮಿಕಲ್ ರಿಯಾಕ್ಷನ್ ಆಗೋದಿಲ್ಲ. ನಮ್ಮ ಎಣ್ಣೆ ಯಾವ ರೀತಿ ತೆಗೆದಿದ ದಿನ ಹೇಗಿರುತ್ತೆ 5 ತಿಂಗಳ ತನಕನೂ ಅದೇ ತರ ಸುರಕ್ಷಿತವಾಗಿರುತ್ತೆ. 5 ತಿಂಗಳು ಸೇಫ್ ಆಗಿ ಬಳಸಬಹುದು ಎಣ್ಣೆನ. ಇದೇನಪ್ಪ ಅಂತಂದ್ರೆ, ನಮ್ಮ ಎಣ್ಣೆ ತೆಗೆದಾಗ ಎಣ್ಣೆ ಕಾಳದು ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಸಣ್ಣ ಪುಟ್ಟ ಪಾರ್ಟಿಕಲ್ಸ್ ಉಳಿದಿರುತ್ತೆ, ಅದನ್ನು ಕೂಡ ಇದ್ರಲ್ಲಿ ಫಿಲ್ಟರ್ ಆಗ್ಬೇಕು ಅಂತ ಸಣ್ಣ ಕಣ್ಣಿನ ಒಂದು ಮೆಶ್ ಸ್ಟೀಲ್ ಒಂದು ಸ್ಟೈನರ್ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳ್ತೀವಲ್ಲ, ಅದನ್ನ ಹಾಕಿ ಕೊನೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಒಂದ್ಸರ್ತಿ ಸೋಸ್ತೀವಿ. ಅಷ್ಟೇನೆ ಇದ್ರ ಫಿಲ್ಟರ್ ಅಂದ್ರೆ, ನಮ್ಮ ಪ್ರೊಸೆಸ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಇದೊಂದೇ ಫಿಲ್ಟರ್ ಆಗೋದು. ದಿಸ್ ಇಸ್ ವಾಟ್ ಯು ಆರ್ ಸೀಯಿಂಗ್ ನೌ.
So because of the slow rotation, there is no heat generated. So since there is no heat generated, the antioxidants which are present naturally in the oil are retained. All the goodness of the oil is retained. So the next question which comes up, yeah, so what he explained is there is some amount of water which has to be added while extraction. So for the water to evaporate, they keep it in the sun for 3 days to 4 days so that all the water evaporates, and then it is packaged into glass bottles. He mentioned that they are amber color bottles so that the sun rays do not enter and there is no reaction, photochemical reactions happening inside the oil. So at the end of doing this, if you are again putting it into plastic, then you are not getting the complete benefits of it. So packaging also is important to be done either in steel cans itself or into the glass bottles as you saw here. So this another question which comes up frequently is, isn't this animal abuse to make the ox go round and round and round? But then usually what happens, everyone wants to keep the cows. Cows are useful because they give milk. But what happens to the ox? Most of them directly go to the slaughterhouses at a very young age. It is quite a lot of expense to maintain a cow or an ox. So no one wants to do that when they are not getting any benefit from it. So in this way at least the ox has a purpose. We humans are very selfish. Unless there is a reason to have to take care of it, we will not be taking care of it. So in this way they have some purpose. Earlier they were used in farming, but now farming it's all replaced by tractors and machines. So ox have no role to play at all. So at least in this way we will be able to take care of few ox in our community. So as long as they are in rotation, usually 2 are used in one cycle, and once after 2 hours they are changed, another set of 2 ox are used. So in that way we can ensure that there is no animal abuse as well in the process. So
if you want to go through that, the benefits of it, it's estimated that we save lives of 22.
Okay, you know, statistics here. Okay.
It's there on the slide if you want to go through that.
Okay.
Small stats that we put together. Actually, it's done by the same person, Naveen, who is a software engineer. 3 of them, they quit their jobs to solve the problem they saw at hand. They put their careers at risk. They're doing a wonderful job. In 2 years, they got broken in. They actually personally delivered to every single customer in Bangalore as well. Right. So they put together this thing. And it's very interesting to go through this. The total population of India is approximately 135 crore people. And assuming that we have 4 persons per family, that's 33 crore families. And on average, if each of them consume 2 liters, then we are talking about 67 crore liters of edible oil per month. Right. If we use ghani oils, then we actually have to install 11,25,000 ghanas in India. We have 6,51,000 villages in India. So if we install 2 ghanas per village, we can solve the entire population of India. And each ghana requires 3 personnel. So which means 33,75,000 rural jobs that we are talking about. Right, and ma'am already covered, bulls need to be employed for this, and it will save 22,50,000 bulls from going to slaughterhouse, right? And then by implementing this, the 3 lakh crore rupees of money would be going back to villages every single month, right? So I think we are done with the slide, but the point is, you know, would there be any rural unemployment, you know, if we have such a money flow back to rural India? Would farmers commit any suicide is the next question, right? So this, all we need to do is switch from refined oil to, you know, edible oil, ghani oil. And in my own family, you know, we used to consume 6 liters of refined oil. After the switch, it came down to 1.5. Even we are saving money by consuming ripe food.
Where you are getting oil?
Okay, so I source everything from the person who is producing it right now in my family. So there is a Ghana in Andhra Pradesh, the person I know personally, I visited that place, I source from him directly. So I take the pain of ordering the thing, he takes the pain of putting it in a bus, we take the pain of that doesn't spill, we talk to the driver, he comes here, and I collect when the bus comes, and then I get to the family, because I take the responsibility of putting the right foot in my children's mouth. That's how I have to operate, and that's how I am. And in fact, in this program, the oils that we used came in the exact same process. We are organizing an event. We are responsible for the oil that we are using in the food that we are preparing. Each of the food items that you consume are the ones sourced directly from the guy who is producing it with the same process that I explained before.
So the next question comes up, which oil do we use? Which oil is good? So I think I've already answered that question, that the more variety there is, the more healthy we are. The same holds for oils as well. Like in millets, like in vegetables and fruits, the same holds for oils. Do not stick to one type of oil only. You have a variety of oils which can be extracted. You can use all these varieties. Some are better suited for some kind of dishes. Say for some are not ideal to be for deep frying. So that you can use when you are making chapatis, millet chapatis, dosa or something like that. Some can be heated to a higher temperature. So it is different with the different oils, but don't stick to just one oil. You can use them in rotation while cooking. So all types of oils are good. Tilla oil, flaxseed oil, Niger seed oil, coconut oil, groundnut oil. We have all types of oils. All of them were used few years back, but now we have restricted ourselves to only a few types of oils. The difference is in the RPM, the rate of rotation. When you use machines, the rate is slightly higher, the rate of circling is higher. So there is a tendency for heat to be produced. Because of the slowness, the heat reduces. So the less the heat, the better is the extraction. It is surely going to be better than the packet oils which you buy in the market, but ideally this would be the best. We still have not come to that aspect, farming and sustainability and.
But can we start such all things in some place, say some rural place?
Yes.
Where there is farming.
That is the idea.
There is the land.
Yes.
People.
Yes.
Is it possible?
Yes. That is how things have happened in Karnataka and in Andhra and in Telangana. Once we start asking for it, there are people who are ready to do it and give it to us. And the main important point is linking the two. So people in the city need the people in the villages to do these things for them, and your money, instead of going to some multinational company, will be going to a rural area. And then the poverty, the whole cycle will be, you'll be helping them as well.
What is the cost
of
the putting such industry?
Agani, you're talking about 1.5 to 2 lakhs.
That's all?
That's all.
You can get the oil?
Yes.
Out of that?
Yes, you can get the
oil. But bullock cost will be extra, no?
Yes, not the bullock cost. I'm talking about the gani cost, unit cost.
Unit cost, but we have to hire bullocks and all, no?
Yes, that I think the villagers will be having. Yes. Yes.
There is no hiring of oxen.
I'm joking, yeah. Bullocks are available everywhere.
Yes, unfortunately, if anyone has visited Andaman Nicobar Islands, the prisoners there were made to extract the oils throughout the day.
Because I am working in very, very rural India.
Yes.
I am working among the tribals.
Yes.
I think those people will be hired.
Of course. So the prisoners in Andaman Islands used to do this almost for 16 hours a day. They were made to go round and round to extract oils. Mainly coconut oil. So it was an island, so a lot of coconuts. That oil was being extracted there.
Like this program is happening, can we have similar programs like village visit, like where all this production is happening, so that we can see and we can understand the actual process? So like through your program,
we will yes. Yes.
I'm very happy with that question, ma'am, to be frank. I guess that's our collective responsibility, and that's 33 people of all of us.
Khargar is a one guy started Khargar.
That's a pretty, you know, I'm very happy to hear that question, you know, than someone asking, can a millet be delivered at my doorstep? Basically, the intention of this program and a duty of all of us, you know, with the knowledge, is to solve that problem collectively. There are places like Eco Village, for example, Govardhan Eco Village, living fantastic job in terms of rural employment. If you go actually see what are the points that we are covering, most of them actually, you know, get hit. So we can work with them, we can volunteer, we can, you know, Keshav Srushti, you know, readily agreed to grow millets, right? If we go there and approach multiple times, they may even put a ghani. So we can actually, you know, extract oils from here and they'll be able to do it. So it's just that we have to pursue it a little more. And the intention has to be that, like, you know, we'll solve the problem rather than someone else solves it for us.
To see those already in place, yes, you will have to travel a bit, probably not yet present here. We are, as I said, we are just entering this new territory now. But already in Andhra, Telangana, Karnataka, there are many of them which have been established. And
they
yes, yes,
yeah,
of course, yes, all this is.
So I just want to highlight one more thing. There is a program called Karu Krishi. We'll be covering that a little later. There's a two-day program, you know, explaining how to grow millets. And within that, there is a visit to Ghani. But this happens in Mysore. We have to organize a session in English. Once that is available, I'll be sharing the wish. Yeah. Kushal takes care of it. So don't leave him.
We have a few participants from here already, Kushal.
Okay. So, the whole purpose is to give a wholesome knowledge. So, just saying correct change rice and wheat to millets, that will be incomplete. There are so many more aspects. So, our next aspect which we'll talk about is jaggery. Most people like sweets. and cannot do without sweets, right? After every meal, we want dessert. Not me, I personally don't like sweets, but most people, many people do say that they like something sweet to eat. So saying don't eat sugar is easy, but then we have to give you an alternative for that as well. We have to not just highlight the problem, but also give a solution to that. So the next alternative for the sweet craving people, and also of course in cooking, it is required sometimes to balance the other flavors as well. So we use jaggery. The question comes up, what type of jaggery is good to use? So there is sugarcane jaggery, which is available, probably produced organically as well. And then we said better than that would be palm jaggery. So the question arises, why is palm jaggery better than sugarcane jaggery? So the answer is that palm jaggery has more percentage of fructose. So yesterday I had explained glucose and fructose combined to form sugar. So it's a sucrose is a dimer of glucose and fructose. So though both of them are C6H12O6, they are mirror images of each other. In our body, though they are so similar, it is only glucose which can be used to produce energy and not fructose. So fructose has to be used. It has to go through a long series of events in which it gets converted into glucose and then only it can be utilized. So in our body, when we consume palm jaggery, the fructose in our blood increases, but that is not going to be having the same effect as a glucose increase. The fructose then travels to the liver, where the liver has to metabolize it. And if there are 100 grams of fructose entering your body, only 30 to 40 grams of it gets slowly converted into glucose. So when you're using palm jaggery, there is not going to be a spike of glucose in your blood. It is slowly going to get converted into glucose 30 to 40%. So this is why we say that it is okay to use palm jaggery and not sugarcane jaggery. Sugar is eliminated. First, we have already rejected it. So better than sugarcane jaggery would be palm jaggery because of the higher fructose element in it. In sugarcane jaggery, again, you have sucrose, which is glucose plus fructose. So there is going to be a glucose spike, and then the remaining fructose is going to 30 to 40% get converted to glucose. So this is the difference between palm jaggery and sugarcane jaggery. So what we usually advise to the clinic, in the clinic for the patients who come to us, diabetic patients who have HbA1c, glycosylated hemoglobin, less than 8 without medication, are free to use palm jaggery as well. So not a problem. You can use this when you want sweets. Same with fruits. Fruits and palm jaggery are similar because fruits, the sweet elements comes from fructose, not from glucose. The sweetness of fruits is because of fructose. So one fruit a day, if your HbA1c is less than 8, is permitted. Be it banana, be it chiku, be it mango. Someone was asking me about mango yesterday. We cannot, mango season is coming up. I will not be able to control eating mango, though I am diabetic. That is one thing which is my weakness. So if your HbA1c is less than 8, you do not have to worry. You can eat mangoes one a day, no problem. When you are completely on a millet diet. If you are using rice and wheat, already your blood glucose is spiking. And on top of that, anything extra will be an added burden to your body. But if you are on a millet diet, then one fruit a day, if your HbA1c is less than 8, even if you are diabetic, is not a problem. And I think he is still under the assumption that he is diabetic. I think your HbA1c is now 6. Then why are you still telling you are diabetic? You are not a diabetic person anymore. It is fixed in our head that it is an incurable disease, that once I have got diabetes, I am a lifelong diabetic patient. We like to label ourselves with disease names, but that is not true. You have cured yourself of diabetes. Please be happy about it and stop saying that I am diabetic once your HbA1c.
Fashionable.
I'm diabetic.
Fashionable. Yes, that has, if we have come to that situation and the patient comes to us, if we tell them a name, they are happy. If we don't give them a name and say, it's okay, we will cure you, they say, no, I want to know what is the name of my disease. We are in such a situation. Okay? Yes, we have not come to the environmental aspect. We will talk about all of that.
So, somewhere I read like the palm jaggery is also having vitamin B complex and
yes.
Protein.
Yes.
And in order to make it, they mix some jeera powder and black pepper. And
there are different processes. I think that is also locally traditions have been different. Some people use bhindi ka juice to make jaggery, to make it solidify. There are different processes.
I guess the question is that okay, ma'am? You know, whatever traditional practices are.
Yes, as long as they're not using chemicals, it is okay.
We are just adding jeera powder and black pepper.
So, any organic way of doing it is, and natural way of doing it is okay.
Cancer patient can have palm jaggery.
During the intensive phase when patients are having cancer, we ask them to avoid all sweet substances altogether, completely nil, at least for the first 6 to 8 months, because in that way you will be starving the cancer cells and have a better chance of reducing the growth of the cells. So any, yes, all fruits and to the patients who come to us, this is what we advise cancer patients. First 6 to 8 months till you get a control over the growth of the tumor.
About the diabetes, so I have seen some people who get a control like BNC after following some diet, they reduce weight. For example, some keto diet they have followed, and after 3 months their BNC is completely normal, no medicines. Only thing is that they revert back to anything. And that diabetes, it increases as though they were never cured. So basically, when a person is said to be non-diabetic, he has a security or insurance against, even if he goes on a bad lifestyle, a person does not get diabetes for at least 40 years. Mm-hmm. When you are not diabetic.
That insurance I don't think anyone has. Even me today, if I am going to eat whatever I like, no one can guarantee that I will not get diabetes. Mm-hmm.
But once the beta cells are died, we say it is cured only when you have good reserve of beta cells in your body.
Insulin production does happen again in those whom it has reduced.
But if you revert, it should not come back again so easily if the beta cells are recovered.
We cannot, that will never happen. I don't think in any disease that is happening now. For you to define cure as saying that reverting back to an unhealthy lifestyle, reverting back to something which you know is not good and still do it and still expect to be healthy, that is not possible.
It takes some time to develop diabetes, right? So your insulin cells do not die out like that. They will burn out after a particular duration.
In type 2 diabetes, it is not necessarily because of the less amount of insulin production. It is because of the less reaction to the insulin. Insulin is there.
That is true. The insulin resistance thing, obesity,
yes,
other things are there. But the diabetes, the time when you get a high sugar in the blood,
mm-hmm,
is when the insulin resistance becomes so high and the beta cells burn out. Some portion of the beta cell will burn out, and at that time you will get diabetes.
Okay.
So the beta cell mass is not a normal for a diabetic person.
Okay.
Compared to a non-diabetic person.
Okay.
So their reserve is actually reduced even if you control their sugar.
But with the usage of Siridhanya, we can regenerate the beta cells to produce insulin.
That's what I am asking. If it is regenerating, whether it is studied, it is proven or not?
See, I already said we do not have any reports to show you or anything like that. That is up for people to research. We are inviting people to do it. no one has come forward yet. We have, in our capacity, what we are doing is a different field. We have not got into the, the so-called scientific study. So we are concentrating more on spreading the knowledge, and we are putting our time and energy in this field.
Because when we claim for a cure of a diabetes, all kinds of scientific people will ask this kind of
questions. Yes, of course.
So the claim is actually made in a more public forum, and you will get it on a pamphlet or something. And then whenever somebody sees that the claim does not match with what they are thinking as cure. For diabetes to be called as cure is a completely different way.
How you define cure, that matters. See, when you are able, if you are eating right, see, now what is considered normal is the question. We are considering eating millets as normal. So you have, if you are saying I want to go back to normalcy, and if you define normalcy as eating rice and wheat, then what you are saying is true. But if what we are saying is normal is eating millets is a normal food, then if you are constantly eating millets, we can say you are cured, because you are not.
That's what I'm saying. When you say these restrictions are being used, then you can control the sugar.
So it depends on your definition of normalcy.
So the normalcy you are saying that you have defined for them, but the world over the normalcy is different.
No, we think that is abnormal.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah,
this
so
is
it,
not a perspective.
It is a perspective.
That's what I'm saying. Beta cell mass is not a perspective. This is a constant measurement.
Yeah, so even the beta cells are getting regenerated.
So that's why I'm saying the study, until unless we do, the claim actually will be objected.
So, as per what you're saying, I should not claim that it is curing diabetes.
Claiming means it becomes a very different way of the scientific people to object to it. They are already against many things.
Yeah, so again, the science itself is becoming questionable. So
you must have observed, no?
Yes.
The people are recovering.
Yes, of course. That's all I can say.
The paper is not published, otherwise.
Yes. So there are many things which are published which are accepted as science but which are questionable. So it's all in how we perceive it. So
because pharma is such a big lobby.
Yeah.
You can't compete with that.
Yeah.
Collective efforts has to be there.
Yes.
Biggest lobby.
True.
I think there is a great food.
Yes.
Maybe if it is in Telugu, if it is in English, I'll forward.
Myth of the scientific myths, right. The so-called scientific myths.
30 to
40
minutes,
it
speaks at length.
Yes.
I guess he has a valid question, but I guess ma'am already answered. We you know, that work has to be picked up by someone and be completed.
In already translating the language, you have to go.
But someone has to pursue that again.
Yes,
so, you know, I wish I'm a scientist, I'm a Kalaroli's volunteer, I would have done that, right? You know, I'm not, right? If I'm a doctor, I would have proved, you know, with my patients and published their reports, with their permission, of course. But I'm not. But if someone.
So, what my father says is, they have designed the game in a way which is convenient for them. So, and they want me to play their game. I don't want to play their game. So if I am a badminton player and they want me to play tennis, I don't want to play tennis. Let them come and play badminton if they have a question about it. If they are questioning it, if they are objecting to it, let them come and play shuttle with me. Then they will know what I am speaking about. I don't want to go and play tennis because it is the game they have designed for their convenience, their own terms. I don't have to prove myself in their terms. I am proving myself in my own terms for the people. So the work is more for the public and for the people rather than to be published in a journal. Yes, that will also come, but that is not my sphere of work. Let someone else do it. Let them come play shuttle. I don't want to go play tennis.
Because
this is what he says.
At present
of course.
Hand, so rather than expecting them to come to you.
No.
You should.
No. That we have tried, that does not work. He used to work in CFTRI, and when he proposed to work on millets, it was rejected. Because of course, even a government institution is funded. So,
funded by again pharma.
Different things. So they prefer to work on soya bean rather than work on millets. You are forced to work on something which they want you to work on. So that is why he quit. That is why he came out. He was basically a scientist. He was working in a bigger multinational company than CFTRA itself. But then when you are there, you are restricted and limited by the organization. So only when you come out of it, are you able to do something which you can reach out to the people. So if we had spent our energies in doing this kind of studies, we would not have been able to reach the people. Once it has reached the people, and then of course there is always the fear of patenting. So if it is patented, the common people do not get the benefits of it. So that we did not want it to happen. So we prefer to go in the opposite route. Reach the people first, let them be benefited, let them see the benefits, and then this can follow.
Many people have faith in science, whether it is right or wrong, that is all right. But if you just make a statement in the scientific community, many people you will get as a follower without actually seeing results.
Sir, we are not even talking to them. We are not even talking to them. So what's the question in proving that, right? And I mean, sir also says, you know, 40% of the doctors have diabetes. So what health are they, you know, promoting?
Yes, yes, absolutely. So, yes, knowing and following is completely
different. And another question to you, thing is, what I eat into my mouth, and what I do, and what I put into my children's mouth is absolutely my choice, right? You know, I don't go by scientific gender, right? I go by my belief system, my conviction, and my gut. So as long as I get that from right source, I don't mind. I don't need a scientific paper.
Yes, many people have been
that. So as long as people, one person is following it, it's okay. We don't need really a scientific paper around it. In fact, I'm sure if there's a scientific enough paper around it, public won't even follow it.
Public means, yes. Maybe the rural public. Okay.
So there, you know, I think I went through one of the articles. C8 Teflon is banned in 2012. That's how many years ago?
Six, seven.
Yes, 7 years ago.
Right? Why they are available in the market? This is by U.S. court banning C8 and Teflon and fining the company which is producing it.
Yes,
and this is proved with scientific, you know, backings, and they proved that it actually causes cancer. So why it's available in the market? So if Kadavali has spent his entire life in coming with the paper, and the paper has no value, you know, two states won't change.
Even Dalta is banned in US, but it is there in India.
Correct. So what's the use of these papers? Right? So all it makes sense is whether it makes sense to me or not. And people have to take a choice. That's what is happening in this. It's not like a conversion that's happening. It's like awareness that's getting spread. It's up to people to take it or not.
We are helping them to be aware of the situation. And once you are aware, it's up to you what you do with the awareness. The problem.
Change of attitude.
Yes. The problem is that these facts are hidden from the common people. Though it is happening, the discussions remain inside boardrooms and do not reach the common people of what is actually happening. What they are eating, they do not know. So we think we are eating salt chips, but it is mandatory that salt chips also contain 22% of sugar. So it does not taste sweet, but there is extra salt added to cover the taste of sugar, because there is a rule that the packeted product must contain this much sugar, because they have to sell it, because they are producing it. So this kind of information is hidden from the common public, and they are in an illusion that whatever is shown is right. So we are just trying to bring out the facts to the people, give it to them, and see what it's left to them, what they do with it after. So our role has been in informing the people. There is, of course, what you are saying is true. We need to do it. But we have left that to someone else to do, and we are doing our role in a different sphere, is what I'm trying to say. Okay? So I think we'll stop for now. Few topics remaining. We'll continue in the evening. Is the nursery thing fixed?